Welcome back to our series on visualization, identification, and estimation in the linear panel event study design. In this video, we're going to think about ways to make event study plots more informative. In the previous video in this series on event study plots basics, Jorge introduced you to the estimating equation that underlies our plots, which is repeated over here. Jorge further explained the interpretation of this equation and its relationship to a standard distributed lag model. If this equation looks new to you, I encourage you to take a look at the video Event Study Plots Basics before proceeding. To quickly recap, Y is the outcome variable of interest here, Z denotes the policy variable, and we will continue to refer to K as event time and the vector delta as the event time path of the outcome. What that means is that we can plot delta against K, and what we get is our typical event study plot. And this typical plot may look something like this. So today I'm going to talk about a number of suggestions for the construction of these very plots. And our hope is that these make your event study plots more informative. Many of these are common practice already, some less so. The first thing I want to talk about is that by construction, the Z terms on the previous estimating equation are going to be collinear. So what that means is that not all deltas are going to be identified, and we're going to have to impose some sort of normalization. So our first suggestion, which is already somewhat common practice, is to normalize the coefficient immediately preceding any anticipatory effect. And often that means the coefficient at minus one. So here, the treatment happens at event time zero. So this is when the event happens. And we normalize the coefficient at minus one immediately preceding the event. We think that the first lead is a good default because this enables convenient tests of hypothesis relative to event time minus one. Throughout the next few slides, I will use the two examples depicted here as running examples. You can think of them as two separate hypothetical data sets that you might encounter in practice. On the left-hand side over here, we have an event study path that is generally decreasing in event time. While on the right-hand side, we have an identical pattern pre-event. So these point estimates are exactly the same as on the left-hand side. Then a jump at event time before this negative trend sort of continues. Now, if I look at these plots, I might like to know something about the economic as well as the statistical significance of my estimates. These plots make that hard to discern, partly because it doesn't convey anything about the overall level of the dependent variable. And so what I mean by that is that the policy effect might be very small, but precisely estimated here. Thus, it might be statistically significant, but not economically meaningful. This brings us to our second recommendation, which is to add a label to your plot that indicates the average value of the outcome corresponding to the normalized coefficient. With staggered adoption at no anticipatory effects, this would simply be the average value of the outcome of interest in the period immediately preceding the event. For example, here, knowing that the outcome takes on a value of around 42, as indicating by the labels up here, might be helpful in deciding the economic significance of the effect. Now, our next suggestion addresses the fact that pointwise confidence intervals are appropriate only for testing pre-specified pairwise hypotheses. So for example, looking at the two figures up here, an ex post concluding that there's a significant pretrend because the coefficient at minus five right here is significantly different from zero is generally invalid, because likely this is not the type of pre-specified hypothesis we were interested in when we ran this event study. And so more generally, since we're depicting the entire event time path on our event plot, we might want to also visualize what type of event time paths are consistent with the data here. So considering the entire path rather than a single pre-specified component of it. In order to do that, we suggest to add uniform confidence bands to your plots. In particular, we found soup T bands both computationally and visually convenient. Now, I'm not going to go into too much detail about these today. But note that our package xtevent has an option to simply add them to your plots automatically. And intuitively, the idea is that these uniform bands give us a way to think about the plausibility of the entire event time path. So for instance, going back to the specific examples here, based on the pointwise confidence intervals, we might have concluded that the lead at minus five, again, this coefficient, take this coefficient over here, might be significant. Now the correct confidence bands to use here are probably the uniform ones, and they actually cover zero in all five pre-periods is indicated by the sort of outer edges of those lines, of the bands. So example, consider an event time path that is zero everywhere leading up to the event. So it would look something like this. The uniform band sort of suggests that you can't actually reject that that is sort of a plausible path that the outcome might take in population here. So it's not clear this path is rejected by the data. Now, there are a few hypothesis tests that are generally of particular interest. One is this test for pretrends that I alluded to already. And relating this back to the estimating model again, the model, if true, implies that leads further out than G leads should all be zero. So our next suggestion is to include the p-value for this test on the plot. So so this is what's done over here. And so this corresponds to this 0.22 here corresponds to the p-value that all of the coefficients pre-event are equal to zero. Of course, similarly, the model also implies that lags further out than m lags should be zero. So we also suggest to include the p-value for similar tests of where the dynamics have leveled off at event time m. And this is indicated by the second p-value down here. Now, one of the reasons I think economists like these type of event study plots is that we may have intuitions about what they look like when the policy is having an effect versus what they look like when there is no policy effect, but there's some sort of confound going on masquerading as a statistically significant effect of the policy in some form of static summary statistic. So for example, you might see a significant static effect in a table for this figure here in a specification with a simple post-event dummy, right? Because you get something negative and statistically significant. But the fact that you can basically fit a straight line through all of these confidence intervals right here likely gives you some pause. The uniform confidence intervals are already helpful for that, but we've developed this idea a little bit further with our next suggestion. So for this suggestion, we suggest to explicitly show something about what kinds of confounds are consistent with the estimated event time path of the outcome in your plots. In particular, we suggest to add the least wiggly confound that is consistent with the null of no treatment effect, where consistent here means that we can't reject the confound path through a wall test. So for instance, if you look at the two concrete examples here again, on the left-hand side, we cannot reject that the true event time path follows this essentially straight line from beginning to end of the figure. So therefore, we might think that this plot doesn't show very strong evidence of a causal effect of the policy. On the other hand, looking at this plot on the right-hand side here, it seems much harder to chalk up this jump at event time we see to confounding alone. The smoothest path we can find that can fit the data here and that's not rejected by wall test still looks pretty wiggly. So you'd have to have these kind of confound dynamics going on to explain this type of observed event time path. Of course, these type of judgments are context dependent because in different settings, different confounds and different dynamic effects, the policy might be plausible. But either way, I think that in a lot of situations, including this type of curve can help your readers form useful intuitions about what the sort of confounds are consistent with the data. So to give you some intuition, our procedure essentially works as follows. We first try to fit a straight line to the estimated coefficients. So roughly you can think of this thing on the left here. If such a straight line exists where an F test cannot reject that in population, the event time path follows that line, we're done and we add that straight line to the figure. If no such straight line exists, we try to fit a quadratic term. If that's feasible, we use the quadratic term with the lowest curvature and add that to the figure. If it's not feasible, we add a cubic term and so on. Again, this is implemented in xtevent in Stata. And in fact, before I conclude this video now, let me quickly give you a quick sense of how our accompanying Stata package facilitates the adoption of the suggestions we just discussed, including the smoothest line. So I have preloaded an example data set here that used the same notation for all variables that we've seen in the slides. And so to run an event study here, I simply type xtevent. I declare the outcome variable of interest. I declare the panel variable, which is denoted by I. Similar, I declare t as time variable. The policy variable is indicated by z. I have to define the window length. And that runs my specification. Now to look at the corresponding event study plots, I simply type xtevent plot, and that pulls up this figure right here. And you note that it includes uniform bands, it includes the label indicating the value of the outcome variable, and it includes the p-values we discussed earlier below the figure. Now we can also add the confound dynamics so the smoothest line that we just discussed to this figure. To do so, you simply write xtevent plot, and you add the smoothest path. And we're going to do some forms of a line. And you get this figure over here. And so in this case, what this figure tells you is that you need a very wriggly confound to explain the event time path of the outcome if there was no treatment effect. So this would this is the kind of confound that you would need to explain the observed event time path under the null of no treatment effect. And with that, I'd like to thank you for watching this video, and I hope you find this helpful for your research.